Hey there, explorers, Brian here. Get ready for a good one. Today we're heading off planet as we focus most of our attention on a nearby star that plays a huge role in our everyday lives. At the center of the solar system is the most famous star. At least the most famous here on Earth. Its official name is Sol, but you probably know it better as the Sun. Make sure you grab a helmet with a visor to protect your eyes before we lift off. Ready, explorers? Did you know the Earth has a twin? It's true. We share a lot in common with our closest neighbor, Venus. So much in common that sometimes the two planets are called twin sisters. They have a similar size, mass, and composition. In many ways, Venus had just as much of a chance to be a life-sustaining planet as our home, Earth. But some major differences prevented that from happening. Venus has an atmosphere made almost entirely of carbon dioxide and nitrogen. Imagine breathing what comes out of the tailpipe of a really dirty car. Gross. That's what the air quality is like on Venus. Venus is also the hottest planet in the solar system, achieving temperatures as high as 900 degrees Fahrenheit. That's even hotter than Mercury. And the atmospheric pressure is about the same as what you'd experience if you were a half a mile deep in the ocean, so it would be tough to stand up and walk around. I guess we had better be glad we're on the Earth, where the conditions aren't always perfect, but they're the best in the solar system for us humans. On that note, make a prediction. Can you name an effect of the sun that makes Earth a cozy spot for us? Respond in the PDF. Maybe you said it keeps the planet at just the right temperature. Let's investigate what makes Earth so suitable for life. Our learning goals for the day are: describe the greenhouse effect, explain why the seasons exist, explain how heat from the sun is distributed around the planet, and explain the sun's role in precipitation. One of the things that makes the Earth suitable for life is its temperature, which is, in part, a result of the greenhouse effect, a natural process that warms the Earth's surface. Gases in the atmosphere trap heat from the sun, which makes the Earth comfortable for humans, animals, and plants. Our twin sister Venus's extreme heat is actually caused by this same effect. Its atmosphere has very high concentrations of these gases. Closer to the equator, the sun's rays hit the Earth more directly, causing higher temperatures. Imagine taking a flashlight and shining it on the center of a globe. The light will be brightest on the globe's equator, but not as bright near the poles. The sun's rays are like the flashlight. Their direct impact makes much of Africa and South America sweltering hot a lot of the time. Greater latitudes have cooler temperatures as the angle of the sun's rays aren't as direct. This is what makes places like Russia, Canada, and Antarctica so cold. Let's consider the consequences for disrupting the greenhouse effect. What do you think would happen if the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere was greatly increased or decreased? Pause the video here to answer. That's right, it could significantly impact the temperature of the Earth. The greenhouse effect makes the Earth warm, but why isn't it warm all year round in most places? The Earth rotates around its axis every 24 hours. At any given time, half of the globe experiences day and half experiences night. But while rotating, the Earth is also orbiting the Sun. It takes about 365 days for this to happen, which is what a year is. The thing is, the axis of the Earth is not perpendicular to the Sun. You might say that in relation to the Sun, Earth's axis is tilted by about 23.5 degrees. As the Earth is in different parts of its orbit, the location on the Earth that receives the most direct sunlight changes. In June, July, and August, the northern hemisphere gets the sun's most direct rays. Imagine shining the flashlight a little north of the equator, making it summer there. During those same months, the southern hemisphere is experiencing winter because the sun's rays are shining on it indirectly. To northerners, Christmas time is branded as a winter wonderland. But in Australia, it's hot. So December 25th might be a great day to go to the beach or have a barbecue. How do you think the seasons would be different if the Earth wasn't tilted on its axis? Respond in your lesson guide. If you said the Earth wouldn't have seasons, you'd be right. It's safe to say that the right temperature allows life to thrive on the planet. But how is that heat distributed around the globe? There are two ways this happens. The first is called convection. As the sun heats up the Earth's surface and atmosphere, winds and ocean currents are produced, which spread the warmth from the sun as they move around. The second way the sun's warmth is moved around the Earth is through wind currents. Polar easterlies, prevailing westerlies, and trade winds help to spread the heat. A similar process is carried out by ocean currents and the mixing of waters around the planet. The last effect of the sun we'll focus on today is its role in precipitation. That's right, there are three kinds of precipitation and all three are caused by the sun's heat. The first type is convectional precipitation. Water heats as the sun warms the hydrosphere. Some water evaporates and rises higher and higher, and then it begins to condense. Water vapor begins to form tiny droplets. This is what clouds are made of. As clouds and the liquid water droplets within them get larger and heavier, they fall back to the Earth's surface. If you live in a large city, you may have seen these types of storms pop up over parts of the metropolitan area, usually in the afternoon as heat from the concrete and tar builds up. The second type of precipitation is called orographic, otherwise known as relief rainfall. This happens when moist air is pushed upward over rising terrain, like a mountain range. As clouds rise, attempting to pass over a mountain, the water within them cools, condenses, and falls back to the earth. The last type of precipitation is called frontal. Storm chasers love frontal precipitation. This happens when a warm and tropical air mass meets a cool air mass and causes precipitation. It looks like a massive wall of clouds in the sky. Which type of precipitation is most common where you live? Pause one more time to answer in your PDF. We get a lot of frontal rain where I live. As we continue in our study of geography, it's important to keep our eye on the climate of the places we visit and its effects on the people that live there. We encourage you to think about the sun's effects on the area where you live, paying attention to daily temperature, seasonal changes, and precipitation. Consider how those conditions impact living things that live a cozy life where you are, rather than scorching on the surface of Venus. And until next time, keep exploring. Hey, hey.